So one of the things that I really wanted to talk to you about are, well, metrics and numbers that sometimes people don't always understand, right? They see them out there because they're important, but they're like, what is scope 1, 2, 3? And there's a new one. I think it's called scope 4. We'll talk about it in a second. But it's important for everyone in this industry to understand that we do this with a lot of thought, a lot of compassion, a lot of knowledge to make sure that what we're building is a foundation for humanity.
Scope 1, 2, and 3 are very, very important because this is how we define, you know, the ways in which we are emitting greenhouse gas into the atmosphere, right? Which is super important. The built environment is responsible for close to 50% of all greenhouse gas emissions. Shocking, right? Say scope 1 is something we have direct control over. Scope 2 is something where we have less control over the product, but we still consume. Mm-hmm. Scope 3 is then further removed from our control. Mm-hmm. As an example, it would be when I purchase a generator, how that got built, where the parts and pieces came from, the transportation to our site, all of that would be scope 3, mm-hmm. right? Scope 2 is more about where we are consuming energy, you know, from a provider. Scope 1 is where I have a fleet of vehicles that I purchase, and then I purchase the fuel that goes in those vehicles, right? Mm-hmm. So those are the examples of scope 1, 2, and 3. Now, it is kind of, you know, that Venn chart where they overlap. So someone's scope 1 could be someone else's scope 2 and vice versa. So it can get a little complicated based on ownership and control. And the batch plants, putting them on site allows us to do a bunch of stuff. Number one, one of our facilities is nominally 17,000 cubic yards of cast-in-place concrete, not including the precast. Each truck that delivers concrete is nominally 9 to 10 yards per truck. Mm-hmm. So that's how many trucks we take off the road per building by having a batch plant on site, a diesel truck that does not have to run 60 miles back and forth in order to bring us our concrete. We have better control, we have better quality, we have less waste, we have better yield. All of those things happen. In addition to that, we can then use a technology called carbon cure where we place it at our concrete batch plant on site. It sequesters carbon from the atmosphere, it gets stored on site, and it gets injected into the concrete, and it strengthens the concrete and reduces the cement content. And on top of that, we layer on an AI that studies all the raw materials that we put into our concrete, and by doing that, we've been able to do performance specifications that have reduced our cement content by nominally 20%. It's amazing.
Wow.
And by the way, cement's the most expensive part to a concrete mix. So it saves you money.
Okay. That's scope 1. Your ownership, you're like, you know, I'm going to take these thousands of trucks off the road. I'm going to, you know, put these facilities on site so I can improve the way I pour concrete in my architecture. All right. Talk about scope 2 here really quick. That Venn diagram is overlapping a little bit. Mm-hmm. That talks about like the fuel and some of the things that we put into our system, the energy sourcing, for example. Now, we talked about this. In fact, we actually saw a truck just on the other side of this facility doing something really cool and kind of scope 2-ish. Tell me about that.
So we like to talk about the things that you can do now. Mm-hmm. Even though the backup generators are what we're talking about here, the fuel that goes in these backup generators. In the data center industry, everyone has to have backup generators for reliability, right? And redundancy. So what we've done at Compass is we are looking at many different technologies to improve the sustainability aspect of a backup generation plan. But in the meantime, we wanted to do something today. So what we did today was we pivoted to HVO fuel because having a biofuel versus a fossil fuel makes a huge difference in sustainability. So that's what we own that. We own these assets. We purchase the fuel. We fill the tanks. We do our commissioning. We top it off with HVO. And then we offer our clients the ability to do the same as they operate and maintain these facilities or if we operate and maintain them for them, right? Mm-hmm. So it's a little bit of a blended line there of we own the asset, but after we turn over the facility, the control of doing that is now via our clients, right? Mm-hmm. So that's where scope 2 gets a little bit, like I said, you know, scope 1 and 2-ish.
Yep. And I think that's a really important point for everybody kind of listening and taking this in, that it's not a scope 1 starts here, scope 2, you know, begins here. It is truly an overlap, which brings us to maybe like a challenging concept to understand. Scope 3. So this is the stuff that encompasses all the things that, you know, we just talked about that actually doesn't encompass what we just talked about. It's all the stuff outside of scope 1 and 2. In the case of, all right, so somebody goes in this facility and they're operating it. Well, now it's like, hang on a second, I'm outside of this realm, but I still got to make sure that they're doing the right things. In that sense, how do you ensure scope 3?
Well, we do have terms with our clients, and we design our facilities around certain criteria that are the energy usage, the PUEs, that are very, very specific in these terms. So the ways in which we use the equipment, the load the equipment, and operate the facility, it's important for us to track that, and we owe it to our clients as a part of their portfolios to make sure we are tracking the actuals compared mm-hmm. to how we design the facilities. So there is there's very good guidelines, on the how to do that so that we do achieve the end result that we design these facilities to function for.
Oh my gosh. Okay, so in your sense, scope three, you might not be operating this facility. Somebody else might be in this environment, but they got to stick to your rules in terms of efficiency, yes. sustainability, power utilization, what they put in these generators, because
we track all of that. We track all of that automatically. It goes on a dashboard. We know the power usage for every one of our facilities.
Scope 3 is a partnership, it feels like, because you take a very proactive approach to ensuring that the things that you don't necessarily manage in 1 and 2 are still looked at in Scope 3. I think that's really cool. Okay, we've talked about a lot, and I know this can get a little bit confusing. And again, it's like a Venn diagram. These things can overlap. Please don't think of it as a scope one starts and ends here. They are kind of meshing together. Okay. So scope one, stuff that you are directly responsible for. We talked about that, the building, the mixing of the concrete, the delivery. Scope two, right? That is the energy that you purchase, the fuels that you put in your generators, making sure that you're responsible for that. Now, and then scope three, we talked about that. That is the encompassing of what is not within scope one and two. And I mean, that's like an important—
Everything else is scope three, yeah.
Everything else is scope three. And those three are really important points. But again, it is a Venn diagram.